ENCODE, I think, is in a line of projects, each of which is trying to provide more and more understanding of how humans work. And that started with the human genome, and ENCODE is the next phase beyond the human genome.
It has produced a large amount of information on the activity of the genome, which is available for researchers worldwide. It has been the contribution of hundreds of scientists all around the world.
So before we had the human genome sequence, we didn't really know what most of the letters of DNA were actually doing. Now we know something around 80% of those letters as a result of the data that ENCODE's collected. And that's kind of removed the definition of junk DNA in some ways. A lot of what we didn't know what it was and we thought it might be junk, now clearly is involved in some sort of function.
Now what we're finding is that the whole genome is alive with switches. You can't move for switches. There are switches everywhere. There is not a single place in the genome that doesn't have something that you might think could be controlling something else. And I think of this almost like sort of successive waves of wiring a very old house, where you've had all sorts of different switches, and some of the wiring's very modern and new, and some of the wiring's very old. And indeed, sometimes there'll be switches, and they're not connected up anymore to anything else. They were previously used, and now they're not. Or they might be used in the future, but they're not being used now. And so it's a much more complicated place than we knew about 5 or 10 years ago, but much more interesting and much more real than our naive views back then as well.
The ENCODE project has actually produced lessons at many different levels. At the scientific level, we now know much more about how the genome works and how complex is actually the working of the genome. So this is one of the issues, the unexpected complexity of the working of the genome that will make actually very challenging but possible the translation of the knowledge of this knowledge into actually technological applications in many different areas, including medicine.
ENCODE is a foundational data set that sits on top of the Human Genome Project. And it's going to be used in many, many different ways. So some basic researchers, I think, will use it as experiments that they might have done but don't have the time or inclination to do, or the money. And that provides a resource to accelerate basic research. But this is also of great interest to people looking at human diseases and human phenotypes, because very often those human diseases and phenotypes are associated precisely with these switches that slightly change the response to certain bits of environments or response to certain infections. And that slight change in response changes how we end up, the sorts of diseases we get, and how those diseases progress. These projects have to be done at scale. They have to be done in these large consortia. There's no way you can concentrate all that scientific expertise into one location or one laboratory. And so, quite rightly, ENCODE has been a large consortia of leading scientists.
But I would say that also is changing a little bit the psychology of scientists that tend to be very competitive. We all want to be the first in doing something before anybody else. And actually here, the way of working actually is quite generous in the sense that we don't mind to, before anything has been ever published, to disseminate our knowledge to the rest of the members of the consortium.
And I think it has driven the science forward, particularly in terms of standards. You can actually go and look at the other model is you just allow science to run randomly. And that collects a lot of data as well. But then when you actually want to compare things and decide are these two things the same or not, because they haven't been collected in a standardized way, it's really hard. And frequently, it's not possible without going and repeating the experiment yourself. Because ENCODE has standardized, it's not only made it possible to compare a lot of things, but it's also actually set a load of standards which others can follow. So other people can go and collect more data if they're connected in the same sort of way, it'll be consistent and be comparable. So I think from this project, we'll build on top of it. This is in some ways the start, because we haven't collected these data sets against all cell types. Not all transcription factors have been collected, but it's clear that you can scale this up in that way.
The human body has hundreds of different cell types, and we have interrogated only a couple dozen of cell types, so we have the need to interrogate how are the cells of the brain, difference of the cells of the muscle, difference of the cells of the bones, difference of the cells of the eyes, etc., etc. So this is one avenue. The other avenue is that we have done this in just some sort of archetypical individual, but what would really be interesting is to perform all these assays in many different individuals and see how the variation in the genome correlates with this variation on the activity on the genome.
What I've learned in ENCODE is that leading scientists are actually very more collaborative than you think, and that you can really produce something far, far better. We have wonderful, wonderful bioinformaticians across Europe, many of them delivering both on small scales and large scales, unique and very effective resources. And by aligning those and by us working together as a consortium, I think we can produce something that is far, far bigger than any single part of any institution or nation.